Rishi, welcome back. Do you know that I know we're going to talk about this, but I don't want us to start with the first issue that is on our Metropole review this morning. But Kenyans can get really funny, and sometimes we don't know the depth of our problems. So now yesterday when, was it on Saturday? Yeah, on Saturday. on Friday, when Governor Waititu got a call from the court that he had to go and answer to the charges. We all do know that the Kiambu County governor went missing for 2 days. So now if you read the memes that were doing rounds on social media, yeah, they were really funny. Now I have one that reads that the lawyer for Kiambu County governor was overheard calling him, saying, "Buddha," that means sir, "unaniaibisha, niko court peke yangu." Is it okay for us to make memes when we've lost money? How would you say it in an ambition cocoot? Anyway, the case developed. Yes, Kiambu County governor came out of his hiding. Good. The wife also appeared at 2 p.m. Well, they were in court, and we have the proceedings of the case. We're going to get there shortly, but now over to serious issues, even before we get to the Metropole review this morning. We're joined by Collins. Collins, good morning. Good morning. Thank you very much for coming to Metropole TV.
Thank you.
Anyway, just in the space of this 1 month, yeah, we have lost three key members of the Kenyan economy. Even before Kenyans recovered from the passing of Bob Colimo, I mean, the conversation was already going on about exactly how and why it happened and the hole that it leaves in the Kenyan economy. We did have the Kibera MP also passing on.
Sure.
Before we get processing that, even before the barrier arrangements are done, even before Kenyans resonate with whatever is going, again, Laboso gone as well. I mean, we are now faced with this news on a very quick succession, but there's one point that is not coming out, mm-hmm, that the cancer conversation.
Sure.
For me now, even the universal health care,
yeah,
it doesn't make sense anymore for somebody who's watching it and saying, well, what does it look therefore to offer me if it can't protect me from a deeper conversation of cancer? Do you believe it's time for us now to start talking about policies that we put in place, mm-hmm, to help Kenyans go for early screening, to help, sure, Kenyans get subsidized price when it comes to screening, so we can actually encourage more to go in for this screening? Where we're saying, let's push for maybe more than 90% of screening in the country, sure, so that we know the stats that we're talking about. From there, then we can get a better healthcare system that looks into issues like this.
Okay. First, my condolences to the family, mm-hmm, and Bomet County for passing on of Dr. Joyce Laboso. She was indeed a trailblazer with regards to women in politics and with regards to her achievements. Yeah,
yes.
It's not a mean feat to be the first deputy speaker, female deputy speaker in this country. She was the first one. Equally, she was among the first women governors in this country. And so for that, it's a blow to the women in leadership and equally to the leadership of this country. That said, the conversation should move beyond just saying we should make cancer a national disaster, but then we should look at how we equip our structures. We don't have enough dialysis centers in this country, in the hospitals, yeah? And so one of the big four pillars is the universal healthcare. It wouldn't make sense if we do not invest in cancer, beyond just the empty rhetorics we keep saying and the sympathies that we dish out when one of our leaders pass on because of cancer. We should now devolve this conversation further and make it a reality.
Yes.
We should invest more on dialysis centers. We should sensitize Kenyans on going for screening, early screening, and we should look at how we subsidize the fees with regards to treatment of cancer in this country, and so that we prevent our leaders from flying out to India. Other Kenyans cannot afford that luxury of flying out to India and UK for seeking medical attention. So we should invest in our health centers here to equip them to be able to combat cancer.
Yes. And one thing that we have really to look at is how we are always reacting. I mean, Kenya never expected that the month of July would be really this tedious when it comes to picking out key members of the economy.
Yeah.
And if you look at the stats, and these are official stats, Collins, they're saying, look, if you come to Kenya especially, and you say, who has the money to go for a cancer screening or to get a proper cancer treatment? All we do know right now is that the government has not subsidized things like MRI scans and a full CT scan that is going to look at whether you have effects of cancer or whether cancer is already in your body. And they're saying, look, you need to have almost 19,000 shillings, therefore, to go for a full scan, an MRI scan and a CT scan. That's going to cost you 19,000 shillings. Now, if 19,000 shillings isn't what many Kenyans will take home by the end of the month. In some cases, actually the majority take less. So don't you think, therefore, that what we have in place right now, we need to react not tomorrow, not anytime soon, but now.
True.
If you go with the stats that, an official again, that 70 people in Kenya would die daily just because of cancer.
And there was a report, I think, in January this year, to the effect that we have 63 members of parliament who are suffering from cancer. Some who are seeking treatment. There are around 18 in India who have been admitted. So far, I know we've lost at least 5 since January to cancer. And so the legislators should be on the forefront to see to it that they make policies that they make it easier for even themselves to seek treatment of cancer within this country. Equally, you go to Kenyatta and the long queues that you find in Kenyatta, at times machines fail to work and a lot of people are discouraged in the queues. I think there's an expose to that effect on how the people, the cancer patients are really suffering with regards to getting treatment at Kenyatta National Hospital. And so the government should, instead of us having beyond zero for just only limited to maternal health care, we equally should have another model beyond zero, but not involving people running.
Yes.
And talking about policies and how we can now affect the equipments to the hospitals to see to it that we improve the kind of cancer treatment in this country. We should not be losing 3 is such a huge number prominent leaders that you've lost this month. And so we need to now move to honor their death, to honor their death in the kind of now invest more in cancer treatment in this country. And equally just sensitize people with regards to screening.
Yes.
Yeah.
Anyway, we're still processing the passing of Joyce Cherono Laboso, who, as you know, also got into politics just because she succeeded the sister, Laboso, who also passed away in a plane crash. Such a sad end to a woman of valor in the Kenyan economy. All right, let's therefore get moving into other issues that are taking center stage into economy this morning. Now, you do know that Waititu gets to sleep in for one more night. Now, Kiambu Governor Ferdinand Waititu has Monday been charged, that was yesterday, at the Milimani Law Courts over 580 million irregular tender. Now, Mr. Waititu has been charged alongside his wife, Susan Ndungu, and several other people following a recommendation by Director of Public Prosecutions, Nordin Haji, last Friday. Now, the governor and his wife surrendered at the Integrity Center after dodging detectives for 2 days. Mr. Waititu turned himself in at around 9:30 a.m. while the wife sneaked in at 2 p.m. They spent the night at the Ethics and Anti-Corruption Commission detention. Now, the anti-graft agency has been investigating allegations of irregular procurement over a tender for the upgrading of various gravel roads to bitumen service in Kiambu County. All this, he alleged, not guilty. Well, yesterday, the charges were being read. And as expected, it's a same song in Kenya, not guilty. So let the case begin. But as we do know, today is a bail hearing is supposed to be listened to this morning.
Yeah.
without preempting or judging exactly what is supposed to happen to him today, him disappearing for 2 days.
Sure.
Do you think that is going to be a factor in his bail hearing today?
It definitely is going to affect, because when you're being granted bail, one of the conditions that you have to satisfy to the court is that you'll remain within the confines of the jurisdiction.
Yes.
And then you'll be available with when you are needed upon. Yeah?
Yes.
But then him demonstrating that he did not appear when he was summoned by DCI, it shows that this guy can easily get away. But then I'm preempting a situation where, a scenario where he's going to be released on bail, but then he's going to be, they're going to be set very strict terms, yeah,
yes,
for him, including him appearing before, I think, DCI every week, every Monday,
just
something
to,
like
just,
that.
Just to make sure that he's still around.
Yeah, and a very hefty penalty, around 60 million bail,
yes,
yeah?
Yes.
Something like that is going to happen. But beyond that, I want us to talk more of these graft cases,
yes,
rather.
Mm-hmm.
Justice Mumbi Ngugi set precedent when she was delivering judgment for the governor of Samburu, Lenol Kulalia.
Yes.
And she was saying that for governors, if you're indicted in a graft case, you should
then
step
you
aside.
Need to step aside,
yeah,
isn't it?
And it,
yes,
has created a conversation around it,
mm-hmm,
saying that when a governor steps aside and then the deputy governor assumes office, what happens when the governor and the deputy governor are charged
indicted,
with graft
cases? Isn't it?
Yeah,
yes,
charged with graft cases. Mm-hmm. You're now saying the speaker of the county will be able to step in. But now the question is, we are saying the governor is stepping aside. Who is he taking the letter to, saying, okay, I'm stepping aside, here I am resigning? Or rather, if it's a speaker taking office, are we having a scenario where, and graft cases in the counties are so huge that a scenario where the speaker, the governor, the deputy governor being indicted is a very simple scenario that can,
yes,
occur. So we are looking at a situation where, what if those three guys are indicted with graft cases? What happens then? Will we be facing a scenario where we have a vacuum with regards to leadership in the counties, or what will we be staring at?
Yes.
There are people with different schools of thought with regards to this scenario. Yeah? There are those who are arguing that the same court was faced with that same question in 2013 when people tried to bar the president and the deputy president from seeking office, when they were saying these guys have been indicted at ICC, and so that in itself affects the integrity to run for office under tenets of Article 10 of the Constitution that talks about integrity and all that. So we are saying then the court allowed them to seek office.
Yes.
But now here, we Justice Mumbi Ngugi is saying for Lenol Kulal, he's not allowed to still hold office. And then they're setting a lot of hefty, stiff terms that are saying you should not be able to access the county offices for this period until the completion of this case. And you know how long cases drag in this country. We're looking at a scenario where a governor will be working as a governor, but then they cannot be able to access offices. And
yes,
that, in a way, stifles the work of county governments. Equally, there is another school of thought that's saying, Justice Mumbi Ngugi read the Constitution purposefully, how it's supposed to be read with regards to Article 260 of the Constitution, that says the Constitution should be read in a manner that supports its vision and purpose. What,
yes,
the drafters of the Constitution had in mind should really be actualized through the judgment.
Actualized through the judgments that the court actually makes, isn't
it? Yeah,
it
should be actualized through the judgments.
And when you look at it, Collins, isn't, mm-hmm, this now, whatever Justice Mumbi is saying, look, if you've been indicted, mm-hmm, in a corruption charge, please step aside.
Mm-hmm.
But the Constitution really says it's upon,
mm-hmm,
if we read what the Constitution says, without, mm-hmm, actually going as per what Justice Mumbi is saying, look, we should read the Constitution as in support of whatever the people who wrote the Constitution really wanted to implement or to foresee.
Yeah, true.
In as much as it might go into second or first interpretation or even third interpretation.
True.
But when you look at that, doesn't it give the persons who are indicted with corruption charges, it's upon them to say, therefore, as of my integrity,
mm-hmm,
and because as a leader, I'm supposed to support whatever it is good for the jurisdiction I've been conferred to.
Mm-hmm.
It's upon me to decide whether to step out or not.
True.
Yes.
Last time I was here, I told you there are articles in the Constitution that look as if they are conflicting.
Yes.
And in this scenario, there are two that come out.
Mm-hmm.
One, Article 10, that talks about integrity of national leaders, yeah, and
yes,
national values and principles.
Yes.
It talks about office holders should have integrity and all that. On one hand, you're saying, if we are asking these guys to step aside because they've been indicted, yeah, we are upholding a tenet of Article 10.
Yes.
This other side, you're saying, you are guilty until you are innocent until proven guilty.
Yes.
This is the other school of thought that you're saying, if I've been indicted, unless I'm proven guilty, I'm still innocent. And so these guys who have been asked to step aside, they can equally ride on that and say, we are being asked to step aside, yet we are innocent. Yeah. You see, so there's a conflicting two articles that are staring at each other, saying, well, this one and we need to uphold integrity, this other hand, you're saying, no, we have not yet been qualified as guilty. Yeah. What I'm seeing, a scenario that is going to happen, and we're going to see an appeal to that judgment, to the effect that we want to know what does this entail when we are saying a governor or a state officer can be entitled to step aside with regards to if they've been indicted to corrupt cases. One of the arguments that I've heard is that deputy governors can use this as a bait, because they can frame the governors, and then after they framed the governors with a graft case, and then they have been taken to court without even being proven guilty or innocent. Yeah, we are going to assume a position where now the deputy governors are going out to take office as acting governors.
Yes.
And most of them maybe are happy at that scenario. Another school of thought is saying, then we are going to have a governor who, when he's faced with graft cases, is going to tag along the deputy governor
and equally tag along the speaker of the county, isn't it?
So that we look at a scenario where we are having a vacuum at the county government, and we'll force now the court to abandon the judgment that is said.
Yes.
But courts can always review their judgments.
Yes.
So the same court that rendered the judgment in 2013 about Uhuru and Ruto not being able to seek office because of the graft cases against them, mm-hmm. is the same court that has reviewed this judgment and given us this one. But now people are arguing that court then had 5 judge bench, but this one has one individual judge, that is Mumbi.
Mm-hmm.
In the past, you've said courts with a higher the number of bench matters with regards to the soundness of a judgment.
Yeah.
Because then we are having a majority ruling on something and then a minority.
It's not even the first time where we're seeing even the number of judges now conflict, because you do know that even this case that just the other day went nowhere, when the Council of Governors and the Senators, when they went to the Supreme Court to look for advisory in exactly what to do with their county allocation and all that.
It was a three-judge bench.
True. That was appointed. But we didn't see anything, because now this issue was actually even solved before the judge bench proceeded. Do you think now it's time now that we actually came up with a proper ruling, probably get the three of them together and say, look, should your name at any one point appear in corruption cases in the country, you have no way other than to immediately come and step aside until your case is well done and settled.
What I know, that same judgment will be challenged. Yeah?
Yes.
It will still be appealed until we get to the apex of the court, the Supreme Court, where it will give now a final decision with regards to that. I think the Supreme Court can equally give us an advisory opinion with regards to this, because this one touches on the counties.
It does.
That is one of
the
purviews under which the Supreme Court can give advisory opinions on with matters regards to county governments. And now this one is really affects the leadership of the county governments. And someone should move to Supreme Court to seek an advisory opinion with regards to whether people, governors or leaders in the county government who have been indicted with graft cases are required to step aside. Until then is when now we'll have a concrete argument with regards to this, and people will be pegging their reasons to this. But then now, if you are going to appeal, people will be pegging their reasons from the judgment in 2013, saying they were not asked to step aside because one of the principles that was being upheld then was that if you're still innocent until proven guilty.
Yes.
That was one of the principles that was based on then. But then equally, another school of thought will be saying, no, we are towards purposive interpretation of the Constitution, and this is to mean that Article 10 should be upheld with regards to integrity of
the case.
Yeah.
Quite interesting, isn't it?
Yeah,
we're watching to see exactly how this goes. And up to now, have we had Rotich come out and say that I've resigned?
He doesn't have to come out.
He doesn't have to come and say that I've resigned, but he's expected to do that. That's what the Constitution expects him to do.
Not really. Yeah.
Yes.
But he doesn't even have office now, because Ukur Yatani has been
appointed as acting position, isn't it? Yes.
You know, the position of CSS is very tricky position with regards to state officials and with regards to their mandate.
Yes.
Because one, they are paying allegiance to the president, because the president is the appointing hand and appointing hand with regards to the cabinet secretary.
Mm-hmm.
So when your boss is the one to call you out, your boss is the one to tell you, okay, you are assigned this duty and you're not assigned this duty. You are withdrawn from this duty.
But when it comes to acting in line with Chapter 10, that says it is upon you to come in and say, look, I'm stepping aside. We've seen in the past, we've seen Sonko do it,
Yeah.
Isn't it? We saw him do it and say, come on. The constitution tells me that I have to step aside and allow for investigations. Mm-hmm. And we saw him do that. Mm-hmm. So were we expecting the same thing? Are we expecting the same thing from this man and Rotich as well?
The constitution is not that clear. It just places a moral authority and obligation on you.
Yes.
And so it's incumbent on you, if you're moral, to come out and do the moral thing, yeah? And and resign. But you know the nature of our leaders in this country. Them and immorality is one thing. So you don't expect one CS Rotich to come out and say, I have resigned from office. Equally, I don't know which office he'll be resigning from, because that office now has a new occupant.
Been replaced, isn't it?
It has been replaced. But then when the charges were preferred against him, that was the time that he would come out and say, okay, allow me to step aside. And
allow for any due process that's going to follow there.
And that will actually work in his favor. If at the end of fullness of time we find that he was innocent, that then it will be easier for him to be absorbed back into the system or any appointed position. But now we are looking at a scenario where if the president decides to appoint him as an ambassador, people will be raising questions. The same person who was indicted with the graft cases.
He didn't come in and talk anything about it.
And it has happened in the past.
It has happened in the past.
We've seen a former CS Bet who was indicted with the graft cases with regards to maize importation. Mm-hmm. Equally, Henry Kosgei. Henry Kosgei now is sitting at JC. We have CS Bet now is an ambassador. You see, it has happened many times. Even Njeru Githae, who used to be finance minister back then, assistant finance minister, is now an ambassador in Washington.
Yes.
If you're indicted with the graft cases, is already a qualification for you to be considered for appointment after you've lost your job in this country.
All right. Interesting. There are a lot of cases that are going on that we are following. We are following the Kidero case. Anything that comes out of it, what we know is that the company in contention has never paid KRA any tax returns. Good. Whether this is exactly what is going to make the president step out in a pomp, we're still waiting to see. And where will this place his fight against corruption? Now, over to another issue. Tobacco farmers' earnings from leaf supplies to BAT Kenya decreased by 1.9% to just 1.46 billion, even as leaf volumes rose marginally. Now, the listed tobacco manufacturer said in its half-year 2019 results briefing last week that farmers supplied 8.9 million kilograms of leaf in the planting season that ended in May, compared to 8.8 million kilograms in 2018. Now, the slight retreat in earnings this year is in contrast with 2018, when the farmers enjoyed a 28% rise in sales to 1.49 billion shillings. Now, the big year-on-year jump in 2018 was due to the fact that production was coming off a depression in 2017. Where we had volumes of 6.9 million kilograms and 1.16 billion in payments. Now, due to a combination of drought and floods in the leaf growing areas. Would you say, therefore, that these industries that are into tobacco and alcohol substances within the economy, because we keep on seeing their tax keep on getting revised upwards in each financial year. You can actually trace it back from 2011 all the way to where we are right now. The tax keeps on rising year in, year out. Would you say that's a factor that is really affecting the earnings of BAT Tobacco in 2018?
Completely. The government wants to make it a luxury for you to use tobacco or for you to consume alcohol. That's why in the many times when budget has been read, they've always targeted these companies with regards to making revenue for the government.
Yes.
And so they've always increased taxation with regards to tobacco and consumption of alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
I think that in a way affects how they are going to conduct the operations.
Yes.
Because if now you have increased taxation and you're still at the same point and you're facing drought, as they're saying, drought was one of the reasons why they had a fallout. Yeah.
Yes.
It's going to affect your operations at the end of the day.
Yes.
But then my question is, why are listed companies, there's a trend with regards to the listed companies and how they are realizing their profits. Most of them are not realizing their profits. Most of listed companies in Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Because it was just the other day that we saw EABL now, some of the beer makers in this country, they're saying, look, because of the tax that are getting imposed on our products, we need to standardize the prices if we're going to actually remain profitable. Because now, some of these earnings that they're talking about, because now people are realizing that you have to pay 10 shillings more. Actually, for a cigarette now, you have to pay 6 shillings more than you are paying for a packet in 2018 now. They're saying, look, we need to standardize the prices, therefore, and say that somebody who's buying a beer in a club in the CBD would buy at the same price as somebody who's buying it somewhere in probably Kisumu now. Because they're realizing that some of these issues now that are coming out, the final end, because now even sellers are trying to adjust their prices to remain profitable, even as prices now, retail prices, keep on increasing. Do you think, therefore, at one point we have to look at it and say, well, even these industries need cautioning from the government?
And you understand?
Because you can keep on taxing them.
True. And you understand where they are coming from. Yeah? You don't expect to be taxed highly and still maintain your prices, because at the end of the day, you are the ones who are being affected.
Yes.
So when you're taxed highly, you have to increase equally the sale of your commodities for you to be at par with the taxation and feel as if you're covered. At the end of the day, equally, as the government is aiming to make it hard for you to thrive, you equally should be making it hard for the consumers to thrive.
Yes.
But then at the end of the day, it's affecting the company, because people will not have to buy your products, because now we'll have a lot of illicit brews coming up to at cheaper prices. We'll have a lot of people making up tobacco at cheaper prices for their consumption.
Yes.
And then at the end of the day, it's going to affect the operations of these companies. I believe that their policy should be in place to regulate how the government approaches such companies.
Yes.
And we've seen it even with betting companies, how the government now is going on an onslaught on them.
Mm-hmm.
We should regulate and caution these companies from the overtaxation that is happening by the government.
Yes.
The government cannot overtax companies with regards to development.
Okay. Yeah.
We cannot overtax ourselves so that we realize development.
Because another thing that is really coming out is that from 2017, now most industries in the country are sort of reacting from that. Even the earnings from 2018, most of them view them as a reaction from 2017, because we do know that the economy senses depression in 2017 and then tends to react in 2018 and the years to follow. All right. Now, I just want us to quickly touch on the next issue now. Konza City. It was sold as a magic bullet to Kenya's development and the manufacturing sector.
Yeah.
They say we're going to come up with proper industries, proper infrastructure. It's been some time now. We've had the engineer come to Metropole Television and say, well, the plans are underway. But do you think that declaring some zones within Konza City and the Konza regions as special zones is going to draw in more local and foreign investors who come in and say, well, the prices have been subsidized and we're getting some benefits if we go in and develop these areas? Do you think that is going to spur the development of Konza City?
It might.
It might.
In Machakos County,
there's
a time the governor, Mutua, was giving out free land to investors.
Yes.
And it was a big question, why are you giving free land to investors? But it attracted investors.
Mm-hmm.
Equally, trying to reduce the amount of taxation. We are saying in these special zones, the taxation is reduced. It's going to endear people, because many times people have looked at those lands to develop and to invest in those lands. But then the kind of land rates that we have, the kind of taxation that we have has put people... has discouraged people from investing in those areas. But this one is an incentive for people to come on board and invest. But even beyond that, even beyond the reduced taxation with regards to land and all that, these companies that you want them to come and set up, what is the scenario for them? What is it after they've already set up? What is the environment for them to thrive beyond that? Do you still have the heavy taxations that are going to they're going to face after they've been able to grow
set
as companies
up and
to set up.
Mm-hmm.
And are we just aiming at these big shot companies, or equally SMEs are going to thrive?
Or sort of a deeper
in
integration within the economy, isn't it?
Yeah,
because
true.
The way it is right now is that if you look at the way they've declared the special zones, they're sort of looking at the big investors and the foreign investors are supposed to come in and sort of get this project spurred.
And so the question is, what is the position of SMEs in this country with regards to manufacturing?
Mm-hmm.
We are talking about we want to get to a point where we have made in Kenya, but we are looking at foreign investors coming to set up their satellite companies here in Kenya, not promoting the SMEs that are here. It's double speak.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, I just want us to go quickly to the next one. Now, Kenya set to hit 60 million subscribers in 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that really stands out is that, look, if you question Kenya's mobile penetration, they will tell you it's more than 100%.
Yeah.
And this is made possible where you have me and you would have maybe two SIM cards. And so when you look at that, our number is more than 100%.
True.
This number is really good. 60 million. And if you look at exactly where we fall, then you're finding that in Africa, we are usually in the top five of the the economies that are actually utilizing mobile technology really that much.
Yeah.
Do you think, therefore, that the government at this point would look at this number and say, good, can we develop our economy and also enable our economy so much around this number? Because this is really good from any point of view.
Yeah, true.
Yes.
That's already an available market that is untapped, the 60 million. And telcos, maybe for the longest time, have used those numbers to thrive in. And you've seen government, for instance, the other day, Parliament was talking about legislating where they limit telcos from venturing into other things, and they require them to have permits when they are when they are going to involve themselves in endeavors that are beyond just communication.
Yes.
I think the government should come up with a good policy to engage the subscribers.
Yes.
With regards to spurring our economy. If we're going to have most of our businesses done online, then that's the way to go, because then you're tapping into the subscribers.
Yes.
This
just
market.
I have one question from you, from one guy called Otieno. He's my friend. He's watching you right now. He's asking, okay, just before we clear this morning, so you've said that it's upon Waititu, therefore, because there's an order already from Justice saying, look, is he supposed to announce it as he goes on with this case or wait for the charges to be read?
To announce?
Is he supposed to announce he's stepping down now, according to what the Constitution says, and say, I'm stepping aside because of whatever I'm going through right now? Or wait for his charges to be heard, for his bail to be read, and then say, now, because I denied and my bail has been read or denied, at this point, I am allowed to step aside?
Well, it's incumbent upon the trial chief magistrate, to pronounce what a High Court did pronounce. And High Court is an appellate, is an High Court with regards to magistrate court, It's now incumbent upon the magistrate who is hearing this matter to pronounce and announce himself with regards to the sentiments of Justice Mumbi Ngugi and say that is what they are upholding with regards to, if they are going to give Waititu bail, they're saying that is one of the conditions, that you should be away from your office. In a way, it's removing you from office through backdoor. But then you don't expect Waititu to come out and say, I'm going to resign from office because of this, because anyway, he has said he's not guilty. So you don't expect him to come and say, I'm resigning from what I've said I'm not guilty to. And most of the leaders are going to use not guilty sentiments to try and exonerate themselves from these graft cases. But then now it's upon the court to uphold the ruling of the higher court, of High Court, rather, and say these are some of the terms that you're setting for you, because that is precedent. It has already been set by Mumbi Ngugi.
All right. This morning, that's exactly what we have for you on a Metropole Review. As we come next, we are talking about getting the links that you need in entrepreneurship. When you think about it, where do you find the sponsors? Where do you find these investors? Guess what? There are companies in the country that are making sure that you have a one-on-one interaction with the people who are supposed to come in and support your business. Next, after the break.